sing all four verses of this song. I sing the mighty power of God that makes the mountains rise, that spread the flowing seas abroad and built the lofty skies. I sing the wisdom that ordained the sun to rule the day. The moon shines full at his command, and all the seers obey. I sing the goodness of the Lord that filled the earth with food. He formed the creatures with his word, and then pronounced them good. Lord, how your wonders are displayed where'er I turn my eye. If I survey the ground I tread, or gaze upon the sky, there's not a plant or flower below but makes your glories known. And clouds arise and tempests flow by order from your throne. Creatures as numerous as they be are subject to your care. There's not a place where we can flee, but God is present there. In heaven he shines with beams of love, with wrath in hell beneath. It's on his earth I stand or move, and it's his air I breathe. His hand is my perpetual guard. He keeps me with his eye. Why should I then forget the Lord who is forever nigh?
This time will be led in opening prayer.
Would you bow with me? Our Father in heaven, we are so thankful for another opportunity to assemble together and to worship you. Father, we have been given so much by you and by your grace, and we are just so thankful for all of the blessings that we have been given in this life. Father, we're thankful for the congregation that meets here at the Somerville Church. We're mindful of those on our sick list, and we're praying for them to be able to get back to their regular walk of life and to get the health that they are used to having. And Father, we're thankful for those that are doing better, as Brother James is doing better, and we pray for continued improvement. Our sister Annie, and we pray for continued improvement. And Father, we pray for many others that have had recent surgeries, and as they are trying to improve, and we especially offer a prayer on behalf of our brother Elliot. We pray for a recovery that will be quick for him. Father, he means so much to this congregation. He works very hard, and we will miss him while he's gone. Father, we're thankful for the elders that oversee this flock. We appreciate so much their wisdom, their guidance, and may we always look to them during our times of need, and may we always trust in their decisions as long as they're making decisions based on your word. We're so thankful for the Manning family, for the work that they give to this congregation. We pray at this hour that the lesson that we will hear will be one that we can examine our own lives and see where changes need to be made and that we will make them. We appreciate so much the hours of study that went into this lesson by Brother Ryan. And we pray for someone here that may have their heart pricked by your gospel. Father, we're so thankful for your Son, for the sacrifice that He gave to make all of this possible. And it's in His name that we pray. Amen.
Psalm for our time of giving is number 12. Number 15, all for Jesus. Number 15.
All for Jesus, all for Jesus, all my being's ransom powers, all my thoughts and words and doings, all my days and all my hours. All for Jesus, all for Jesus, all my days and all my hours. Jesus, all for Jesus, all my days and all my hours. Let my hands perform His bidding, let my feet run in His ways, let my eyes see Jesus only, let my lips speak forth His praise.
You know, there are times when I have to stop and say, Lord, forgive me for taking so many blessings for granted. You know, in Luke chapter 6, verse 38, the Lord outgives us. When we see there, you give, and I will give back to you a full bag, a full bag. And you know, another thing that I'm so thankful for, living in this time, I don't have to sacrifice a calf. I don't have to sacrifice a goat. And I don't have to sacrifice a lamb. You know, the Lord told us, just give. When you come together on the first day of the week, give as I have given to you. And that is so easy for us. So we have so much to be thankful for. And we do it not grudgingly, but have a real happy feeling about it, because we're giving back part of what He's given us. We are, Father, thankful for so much. And we're thankful that we have the opportunity to give back to You a part of what we have been blessed with. Help us all, Father, to have the happy heart, not grudgingly, but give back as we are given. This we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
We'll sing number 447 before our lesson. If you would like to stand, we'll sing Near to the Heart of God together.
There is a place of quiet rest near to the heart of God.
like Mark the song of invitation. It is number 768. While we pray, 768.
Communication forms a building block to human civilization. Everybody communicates, and we spend our entire lives learning how to speak, learning what to say. See, communication gives us power. It allows us to form societies. It allows us to accomplish so much. Yet, communication also has a dark side. Communication gives us the ability to turn our words from helpful and loving to hurtful and hateful. Now, James addresses the topic of human communication in the third chapter of his book. James, inspired by God to write these scriptures, examines what happens when we let our communications go unchecked and go uncontrolled. And James identifies a problem that we'll call the broken rudder. Then he illustrates that problem so that we can learn about the dangers of the tongue. Finally, James shows us how our uncontrolled tongues make us inconsistent, resulting in our failure to please God. So let us notice three things from James chapter 3 about this problem of the uncontrolled tongue, uncontrolled communication. First of all, let's notice the problem's identification. The chapter starts with this warning: "My brethren, be not many masters, knowing that we shall receive the greater condemnation." Now we have to ask, does this verse discourage people from becoming teachers? And as we look through the scriptures, it seems that Hebrews 5:12 sort of contradicts James 3:1. Because Hebrews 5:12 says, "For when for the time ye ought to be teachers, ye have need that one teach you again, which be the first principles of the oracles of God, and are become such as have need of milk and not strong meat." So do these passages contradict one another? What does James 3:1 really mean? "My brethren, be not many masters, knowing that we shall receive the greater condemnation." How can we reconcile these two passages? Well, we must understand that James 3:1 does not forbid, and it does not even discourage, all people from becoming teachers. James 3:2 begins with the word "for," which gives us the reason why people should refrain from becoming teachers. If you look, it says, "Be not many masters, knowing that we shall receive the greater condemnation, for..." "For in many things we offend all. If any man offend not in word, the same is a perfect man, and able also to bridle the whole body." Now, let's put those first two verses together. And when we do, they teach us that certain people should not become teachers. If we look at those two passages, those verses teach us that people who offend in word ought not become teachers. However, we also see from this passage the ideal of the perfect person. It says, "If any man offend not in word, the same is a perfect man, and able also to bridle the whole body." Perfect there means complete or mature. It does not mean sinlessly perfect. It means somebody who has grown to maturity, someone who has, through prayer, through experience, through the help of others, grown as a person through study of the scriptures. And this ideal we can see here in James chapter 3. Now, we also, when we continue reading in James chapter 3, we see later in the chapter, people who do not control their tongues, They contradict themselves. They hinder their own spiritual growth. We find that in verses 10 through 12. Thus, James, he means for us not only to aim for that spiritual maturity, to aim for that control over our tongues, but James, and consequently God, who inspired James to write this, believes it possible to reach that goal. And he expects Christians to control their tongues. He does not want us to go around saying, oh, I can't control my tongue. I have no ability to control my tongue. He doesn't want us to think that. The way we speak can hinder our effectiveness at teaching the gospel. Because it says, be not many masters, knowing we shall receive the greater condemnation. And in this context, James talks about those who cannot control their tongue. When we don't have a filter, when we don't have a control over the things that we say, what can it lead to? Well, it can lead to our condemnation, as the verse says, because when we teach others, we do bear this great responsibility. And we all will have to answer for the things that we say. Look at Matthew chapter 12. And listen to what Jesus said. He said, but I say unto you, that every idle word that men shall speak, they shall give account thereof in the day of judgment. For by thy words thou shalt be judged, and by thy words thou shalt be condemned. So how could we teach others about holiness? How can we teach others about doing right, about following God, if we don't have self-control? And James 3 ultimately teaches us that we must have this self-control. James' warning to aspiring teachers bears similarities to a statement that Jesus made about judging. In Matthew chapter 7, the chapter begins with these words that Jesus said, judge not, that ye be not judged. For with what judgment ye judge, ye shall be judged. And with what measure you meet, it shall be measured to you again. Now at first glance, this looks sort of similar to the statement, be not many masters. It looks similar to that because it says, judge not. And we have to ask, does this verse prohibit judgment? Well, it can't prohibit judgment. Because when we look and when we read the Bible, and the Bible tells us something, and the Bible calls something right, and we say, I believe the Bible, well, we've just made a judgment, haven't we? When somebody does something that goes against what the Scriptures say, and we say, you've disobeyed God, we've just made a judgment, haven't we? Actually, when I wake up and say I feel good this morning, I've made a judgment. You can't go through life without making judgments, without making decisions. So when Jesus says, judge not that ye be not judged, he doesn't mean don't ever judge. In fact, this verse, like James 3, 1 and 2, also gives the reason for not judging. It says, for with what judgment ye judge, ye shall be judged. And then he goes on to talk about trying to pull a speck out of your brother's eye when you have a beam protruding from your own. Well, when I have the same problem that somebody else has, how can I judge them? How can I, and the judgment that we make toward others comes from a desire to help them get to heaven, to help them improve. It doesn't come from the need for me always, you know, to speak right, to have the right answers. It comes from me wanting to help. And God says, you need to judge with that kind of judgment. But then Jesus says you can't try to pull a speck out of somebody's eye when you have a beam protruding from your own. When we struggle with sin, we can't judge others for their sin. God will judge them, sure. However, Jesus said later on in verse 5, he says, "Thou hypocrite, first cast out the beam from thy own eye, and then thou shalt see clearly to cast out the mote out of thy brother's eye." Let me ask you a question. How can you cast a mote out of your brother's eye? And we understand a mote to mean some sort of sin that they're doing, or that some sort of sin that your brother commits. How can we help them cast that beam out of their eye? Well, we have to make some kind of a judgment, don't we? Jesus tells us then not to refrain from judging, not to stay away from that. He tells us when you make a judgment, when you help somebody through sin, help them come out of sin, you have to make sure your life lines up with God first. Now, what does this have anything to do with James? James says something similar. See, Jesus said, don't judge. And everybody looks at that and says, you can't make a judgment about me. You can't say I'm wrong because the Bible says don't judge. And you just read 4 or 5 verses and you realize Jesus never said don't judge. He said, judge not lest you be judged. Completely different. Now, go back to James, and what does James say? Be not many masters, knowing that we shall receive the greater condemnation. Who here, I guess I can't ask anybody to raise their hands, but I don't think anybody would. If I asked you to raise your hands, who here expects to receive condemnation? Who here expects that? Who comes every Sunday so that they can receive condemnation, whether it's greater condemnation or lesser condemnation? Because James says, do not be many masters, knowing that you shall receive the greater condemnation. Who here wants that condemnation? Nobody does. Who then does James caution against being a teacher or against becoming a teacher? Those people who cannot control their tongues. Those people who cannot control themselves. As we continue in James 3, we're going to learn that our speech, it's not just that our speech causes problems for us. It also, we're going to learn how the tongue operates. We will learn the dangers of leaving our words uncontrolled. So let's come to the second point. We saw the problem identified. Now let's look at the problem's illustrations. The problem's illustrations. James uses the power of illustration, and he teaches us several things. I like this chapter because James teaches us with things that we can imagine. We can take that as a lesson. Teachers, take that as a lesson. Get people to imagine things. Use examples. I say this to myself as much as anybody else who teaches. First, James uses the examples of horses and ships to show us the tremendous impact that our speech has on our lives. Behold, verse 3 says, we put bits in the horses' mouths that they may obey us, and we turn about their whole body. Now, even though horses have greater size and they have greater strength than humans, they still go wherever those little bits in their mouths tell them to go, don't they? And we can control an animal with just a little bit of pressure. It doesn't matter how much strength a person has. If you apply pressure to the right places, to the right pressure points, you can cause even the strongest people to go wherever you want them to go. I consider myself kind of tough. Not you know, way up there on the spectrum, but not a wimp either. But you grab my fingers, you bend them backwards, and I'll go with you wherever you want. It's just pressure in the, just pressure applied in the right place. There's whole martial arts designed to show you, you know, where to put pressure. And even the largest and strongest of people will go where you want them to go. Well, the bit in a horse's mouth, you pull this way, and that bit, and the horse turns. James 4 uses talks about the example of the ships. It says, "Behold also the ships, which though they be so great and are driven of fierce winds, yet are they turned about with a very small helm, whithersoever the governor listeth." Now, mankind has built some impressive vehicles. And most of them have something in common. We steer them with something small, don't we? For example, a steering wheel turns the wheels on a car or a truck, and it doesn't matter the size of the truck. You still turn it with the same size steering wheel, something that you can hold in your hands. How about a fighter jet? Use a little joystick, and it controls that fighter jet that goes faster than, well, than anything that we've ridden in. Or a helm that James talks about. It moves just a small rudder, which in turn steers even massive ships. Even in the sea, even the creatures in the sea, the whales and the fish in the sea, they use their fins. Small in comparison to the size of their bodies, yet they change their course and they keep them gliding through the water with ease. All of these things mentioned obey the commands of something very small. James uses the ship as an example. He uses the horse. He says the ship, it says, though they be so great, though they are driven of fierce winds, yet they're turned about with a very small helm, whithersoever the governor listeth. Second, he uses the illustration of fire to show us how much harm our little tongues can cause. See, our tongues have an impact on our bodies. Our tongues control the direction we go. But the illustration of fire teaches us how much harm that we can actually do. Verses 5 and 6 says, "Even so the tongue is a little member and boasteth great things. Behold, how great a matter a little fire kindleth." And the tongue is a fire, a world of iniquity. "So is the tongue among our members that it defiles the whole body and sets on fire the course of nature. And it is set on fire of hell." Now, human beings could hardly survive without communication. We communicate for nearly everything that we do. Try to think of one thing in your life that you don't communicate for. Well, we communicate for anything that requires money, because making money itself requires communication. Transactions where you pay somebody, that requires communication, else you wouldn't know how much to pay a person. Our food, our water, our houses, our medical care, all of these require those little tongues that we have. And of course, the tongue really does represent all forms of communication. Somebody who doesn't speak except with their hands, they speak in sign language, maybe. They still need to read about the dangers of the tongue, because the tongue stands for communication. But the tongue, then, a very small organ, it impacts our lives in such a meaningful way. Thus, James says that the tongue boasts great things. And it does. Entire civilizations have risen and fallen on the words of their people. Proverbs 12:18. "There is that speaketh like the piercings of a sword, but the tongue of the wise is health." Words can do damage then, can't they? You know, we say that rhyme, "Sticks and stones may break my bones, but words can never hurt me." But words can do far more damage than sticks and stones. Because words cause people to go and hurt others. Words motivate people. Words convince people. The example of fire really illuminates the destructive capacity of communication. Now, in the previous example, the bit in the horse's mouth, the ship's rudder, we can see the potential for harm. Like, just imagine what would happen if you riding a horse accidentally pulled on the bit and your horse went off a cliff or something. Or imagine if a ship, what could happen to it if the rudder gets stuck or if the captain does not pay attention to the ship's course. Well, the ship could run aground. It could strike rocks and sink, and lives could, and people could drown because, well, that rudder didn't point the ship in the right direction. What happens when you have a broken rudder? Well, this illustration of fire, it illuminates how destructive communication can, the destructive power, rather, of communication. James says, "Behold, how great a matter a little fire kindles." How great a matter can a little fire get? Well, just think to the fires in Gatlinburg last year. And what happened? Just because some kids played with fire when they shouldn't have. Think of how many people lost their homes, how many people lost their lives. Think of the destruction because of just a little fire. Think of the destruction because of just a few words. The relationships torn apart because of the things that we say. Now, for a third illustration, James turns again to the animal kingdom to teach us that we should never speak carelessly. James 3, 7 and 8 goes back to this, the animal kingdom. It says, "For every kind of beast and of birds and of serpents and of things in the sea is tamed and has been tamed of mankind. But the tongue can no man tame. It is an unruly evil full of deadly poison." You can put a saddle on an elephant and ride it, can't you? You can turn on the television and watch humans do amazing things with animals. People swimming with killer whales. Lion tamers. Have you ever seen a lion tamer put his head into the mouth of a lion? I have. You know what else I saw? I saw him take his head out of the mouth of the lion. Equally as impressive, right? You put your head in the mouth of a lion, you know, you impress people, but you take it back out again without him biting down. That means you've trained that lion. The king of beasts, right? The king of beasts answers to human beings. But then James 3 says, every kind of beast, birds, serpents, things in the sea is tamed and has been tamed of mankind. But look at verse 8. It says, but the tongue no man can tame. It is an unruly evil full of deadly poison. Now, does this mean that we should just give up? Does this mean that we cannot tame or that we cannot control our tongue? What does James mean when he says that we cannot tame the tongue? Well, we know the difference between a tame and a wild animal. A tame animal generally does not pose a threat, does not need constant control. Like, for example, my cat. I would call my cat a tame animal. And she poses a threat to just about nobody. She even got mad at Liliana yesterday, and she hissed at her, and then went like this. Put her mouth on her hand. Didn't bite. Considered it. Let go, because she saw me watching. And Liliana walked away, thinking, oh, nothing has happened. She laughed at the kitty. I'd call that a tame animal, wouldn't you? Wouldn't even hurt a baby, even when she's mad at the baby. Wild animals, however, they present real damage. And humans must respect that if they want to stay safe. For example, that guy on TV who went to live with bears. And that didn't end well, did it? You go live with bears, you'll get eaten by bears. Because bears live in the wild. You can't call them tame animals. So when the Bible tells us that we cannot tame the tongue, what does it mean? Well, it means we can't, it does not mean that we can't control our tongues. Remember, verse 2 tells us that people who control their tongues have maturity. What it means is we can never let our guard down. Just as we would exercise caution then around a wild animal because of the harm it could do, we must always remain alert to the fact of what our tongues can destroy with just a single word of gossip, just a single word of rumor spreading or slander or something said in anger or ridicule or scorn. We will never tame our tongue to the point where, oh, well, it will never hurt anybody. We must always watch. We must always understand the power that we hold with our words, the destructive power. Ecclesiastes 10, 11 and 12. Surely the serpent will bite without enchantment, a wild animal. And a babbler is not better. Someone who cannot control his tongue, no better. The words of a wise man's mouth are gracious, but the lips of a fool will swallow up himself. Let's notice the third point that we see in James chapter 3, the problem's inconsistency. When we do not control the way we speak, we start manifesting hypocrisy. James 3, 9 and 10, therewith we bless God, even the Father, and therewith we curse men, which are made after the similitude of God. Out of the same mouth proceeds blessing and cursing. My brethren, these things ought not so to be. God wants us to speak consistently. If we say good things about him, then we must say good things about our fellow people. Now think about this for a minute. Think about this the next time you feel tempted to unleash some kind of barrage of bitter words towards somebody that has angered you or that has irked you or that you don't like. Would you say those words to your heavenly Father? Because it sounds here that God wants us to talk to people the same way we would talk to him. If you heard a rumor about Jesus, would you gossip that rumor to everybody? Or would you stop that rumor in its tracks? Nobody would say, oh yeah, I would gossip about Jesus. And I'm sure people did. When Jesus walked this earth, they called him a glutton and a winebibber, didn't they? But would you, if you wouldn't gossip about Jesus, if you wouldn't say something hateful and spiteful to God, why would you say it to somebody who God made in his image? James wants us to get that point. Unfortunately, today, too many people take the Lord's name in vain. They don't even respect God in their speech. Well, James uses two more illustrations to drive his point home and to teach us consistency in how we speak. 11 and 12 says, doth a fountain send forth at the same place sweet water and bitter? Can the fig tree, my brethren, bear olive berries, either a vine, figs? So can no fountain both yield salt water and fresh. James presents these last two examples as, notice, impossibilities. He means us to equate these two impossible scenarios, a fountain that sends forth salt water and fresh, a fig tree bearing olive berries, or a vine bearing figs. He means us to equate those with the tongue that speaks blessing and cursing. Now you say, wait a minute. We have the ability to do this. The possibility occurs to speak good and evil, but such speech will remain impossible for anyone who wants to please the Lord. Thus, he says, these things ought not so to be. So what will we do with our communications? Will we give up and vow never to become teachers? Well, if we do that, then we also resign to live in sin because, and we resign to have our spiritual lives ravaged by this hellfire that James talks about, set on fire of hell. We resign to living with our moral compasses compromised by a rudder, a broken rudder, turning us the wrong way. We resolve to live with those around us terrorized by our own wild beasts that we unleash every time we open our mouths to speak. Colossians 4:6 says, "Let your speech always be with grace, seasoned with salt, that ye may know how ye ought to answer every man." Fortunately, the Bible tells us that we can control our tongues. And we have examined James's great chapter on the dangers of unchecked communication. We've seen the problem identified. Then we've seen it illustrated with the numerous things that we can imagine. Then finally we learned that when we speak with uncontrolled tongues, we become hypocrites, inconsistent. So what will we do to make sure that we speak in such a way where we can become teachers of the gospel? Where we don't have to worry about receiving any kind of condemnation. You see, if I teach and I show self-control, I don't have to worry about the greater condemnation, do I? I only have to worry about that when I can't control my tongue, when I can't show that self-control. Let's each one of us try to live, do our best to live, to speak, and to say things, as Colossians says, seasoned with salt. And with grace, so that we can know how to answer every man, every person. What will we do with our tongues today? How will we speak? How will we communicate with others? We're going to sing an invitation song now. And as we sing this, consider what God has done for us. God sent his son Jesus to die on the cross so that we can have everlasting life, so that we can have his blood which washes away all of our sins. Jesus lived a perfect life. Jesus knew how to control his tongue as well as his actions. And because of his sacrifice, we can have freedom from sin, from the despair of this world. So if you here today have something weighing your conscience down, this invitation song we sing for you. If you need to respond to the invitation song to be baptized into Christ, to submit to baptism, then you need to do that. When can someone be baptized? Well, baptism comes after one has heard the word of God, has believed that in Jesus Christ, the Son of God, has repented of their sins, has confessed that belief that they have before other people. Then, and only then, can you contact the blood of Christ to have your sins washed away. Maybe someone here today comes as a Christian but has strayed away. Maybe you have a problem with the way you speak. Maybe you have a problem with the way you use your communication and need to fix that. Maybe you have another problem and you need to repent of the sins that you have committed. The Bible tells us that we must live faithfully unto death if we want to receive that crown of life. So if you have a need, why don't you make that need known while together we stand and sing the invitation song?
While we pray and while we plead, while we see your soul.
prayers, but she says sometimes she struggles with patience. Sometimes she gets frustrated and things come out that she knows she shouldn't say. And she says she prays for patience. And she wants us to pray for her that she'll have that. Our Heavenly Father, we thank Thee so much for our dear sister Sue Friels. Thank Thee for her heart and her desire to follow Thee, her desire to speak with patience. And help her when she fails. Help her to overcome that impatience. Help us to encourage her. Help us also to learn ourselves to have more patience. Father, we thank Thee for giving us this opportunity to come and to pray today and to repent from things like this. I thank Thee so much. I pray in Jesus' name.
The song to help prepare us for partaking of the Lord's Supper is How Deep the Father's Love.
How deep the Father's love for us, how vast beyond all measure, that He should give His only Son to make a wretch His treasure. How great the pain of searing loss, the Father turns His face away, as wounds which mar the chosen one bring many souls to
Six hours, one Friday, hanging on the cross for you and me. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever should believe on him should not perish, but have everlasting life. As he hung there on that cross, the last 6 hours of his life, and we look there at John chapter 19, verse 30. Our Lord uttered three words that made a difference in the world. It is finished. In Luke 19, verse 10, Jesus said, I come to seek and save that which is lost. In John 10:10, I come that you might have life and have it more abundantly. On the night before his betrayal, he instituted a memorial for us to remember what he did for us on that cross. He took the unleavened bread. This is my body. Take it, eat it, remember me. He took the fruit of the vine, which represented his blood that was poured out there on that cross because of the sword that pierced his side. The fruit of the vine represents what he did for us. Mark 10:45. I didn't come to be served. I came to serve you. In Acts chapter 20, at verse 7, we have the example of the apostles meeting together upon the first day of the week to partake and to commune with God. In 1 Corinthians 16, verses 1 and 2, we're told when you come together on the first day of the week. When you come together on the first day of the week, we're together on the first day of the week. Our Lord is with us here. In Matthew chapter 26, I'm going to commune with you after this betrayal time. I will commune with you in the kingdom, partaking of these emblems. Lord, when we think about what you did for us, we're so thankful that we don't have to go through that. You did it for us. You paid the price. You paid the ransom. Thank you, Lord, for going to that cross and shedding your blood for me. This I pray in your name. Amen. That unleavened bread represented his body. Lord, as we come to you now, remembering what you did for us, and as we partake of this fruit of the vine, we remember that blood that was shed that we might have hope of eternal life. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
In just a moment, we'll sing number 647, The Love of God. This will be our psalm before our closing prayer. If you are visiting with us and aren't as familiar with our services, after our closing prayer, we have our hour of Bible study. And there are classes in this building as well as the building directly behind us for any and all ages. So we invite you to stay for our hour of Bible study. Following that hour, we have our second and final service of the day. So there'll be another lesson and more time of singing and praise. And we just invite you to stay for our second and final service of the day as well. Before all that, if you will, please stand. We'll sing this song together.
Since the love of God has shed priceless blessings on our head, I have made.
Jesus. Would you bow with me, please? Our dear Heavenly Father, we are so grateful and thankful unto Thee for Your love and caring for us. We're thankful, Father, for all the things that You have done and continue to do on our behalf. And Father, we're thankful for the church that meets here at Somerville. We're thankful, Father, for the work that goes on, the jail ministry, and all of the other things that goes on here. We pray, Father, that You'd continue to bless us. Bless the ones that's grading papers and teaching classes and doing all the things that's necessary here to teach others. And Father, we're thankful for Brother Ryan, and help us, Father, to control our tongues. Help us to be mindful of others and their feelings and things that we might say and do to hurt the church here or hurt others. Father, we know that we do say things and without thinking sometimes, and help us to think before we speak. And Father, we ask Thee to be with all of us. Be with Brother Michael as he brings us a message the next hour. Brother Nathan as he leads our singing. We're so thankful, Father, for them. Thankful, Father, for the classes that we're fixing to, getting ready to go into, that You would be with us as we, as students, as listeners, that we might gain much from it and be better servants and better Christians and better brothers and sisters and better in all ways, Father, as we live here on this earth. We ask Thee to forgive us our sins and be with us always, is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen.